Resolution is a horror film from 2012, the debut feature of directors Justin Benson and Aaron Moorhead. It mostly takes place in this cabin where a meth addict, Chris, is being held against his will by a friend, Michael, who is trying to force him to go to rehab.
Do you know why Jimi Hendrix died?
He didn't have Mike DeNube and a set of handcuffs to save his life.
They keep finding these bizarre and disturbing documents, photos, audio recordings, film strips, video files.
Where's the rest? There isn't any more. I'm not lying to you. What's that? No!
But Michael doesn't call them documents or recordings. He calls them stories.
Do you think someone's leaving these stories for us to find?
I think people leave their shit everywhere and you fucking take it personally.
And that's because Michael thinks in terms of stories, narrative. Even this thing he's doing is a way of him telling a story about himself and how he's a good person, and about Chris and how Chris needs to be saved.
I never enjoyed life until I started doing drugs.
Okay, I know that's not true.
It is true. Our childhood, I was miserable. Our adolescence fucking sucked.
I saw you happy before that.
Now I was being played.
This act of turning Chris into a character in Michael's story flattens him into an addict and only an addict, instead of a person with agency, self-awareness, and complexity.
You're saying I'm sick? I never called it a fucking illness or any of that shit at all, so fuck off.
The creepy stories they find become centered on the two of them. They receive video footage of things happening right now or things that might happen in the future.
Did you see that? I see what?
What?
That.
There's something out there turning their lives into a horror story.
I think it wants a story.
That's it? That's all?
I think it wants a story with an ending.
Their attempts to escape are thwarted by story logic, and Michael realizes that if they want to survive, they have to appease this malevolent mixture of writer and audience. Chris agrees to go to rehab, accepts the characterization Michael has chosen for him that he's resisted throughout the film, and is unclear how much of this is genuine, and how much of this is trying to give the entity an ending that will be narratively satisfying and thematically relevant. But maybe it doesn't want a happy ending. It's not that kind of story. This is a horror film, after all.
Can we try it another way?
I exist to the side of the board game industry, so in order to sell my games, I really need to sell myself, really need to tell a story. In the beginning, that was a love story about my wife Mary and I, best friends, inseparable, running a mom and pop operation together. Now, the end pop part turned out not to be true. I didn't know that at the time, but it was a true story. In order to be a story, though, in order to be comprehensible and useful, we emphasized the parts where we were on the same page and didn't talk about all the times that we hurt ourselves and each other trying to be what the other one wanted. Didn't talk about how it curdled over or how long it had been sour. The relationship did not survive my transition. The final collapse in 2021 was messy and private. We are still friends, we are still business partners, and for a time, we were still living together. I started dating again in 2022, and the first time I stayed at a partner's house overnight, Mary had a pretty big reaction to it, and she posted online from the company social media accounts about how her heart had been breaking for months and now it had finally broken. And that led a lot of people to say some unkind and untrue things about me. So I found myself in the position of having to make a public announcement to thousands of strangers about something that wasn't their business, letting them know that that relationship was over. And when it happened, I had several people reach out to me, both privately and publicly, to let me know how heartbroken they were about the end of my marriage. And they hoped that we would figure it out and get back together, because we were one of their favorite couples. These strangers were shipping me with my ex. I hated that. It made me sick to my stomach. And really, they were shipping the versions of us that we had shown them. That's the thing that really upset me. The sense that, actually, it was kind of my fault. I did this to myself.
What happens when you turn real events and people into stories is the subject of the 2001 film Storytelling, directed by Todd Solondz. Solondz feels like he's pretty obscure these days. He was a lot more prominent in the 90s and aughties. He has a reputation as a cinematic provocateur whose black comedies often deal in edgy and taboo subject matter, centered on characters who are pathetic, stupid, or repulsive. He's often accused of being smug and mean-spirited, feeling superior to his characters, and Storytelling is at once a defense from these criticisms, but it also leans into them as hard as he can.
Why do people have to be so ugly? Write about such ugly characters? It's perverted.
Like by using taboo language, you were trying to shock us about the hollowness of your characters.
But it seems glib and facile to just make fun of how idiotic these people are.
I'm not making fun. I'm showing it as it really is.
You're showing how superior you are to subject.
No, but I like my subject. I like these people.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do. I love them.
Storytelling is split into two parts. Fiction, which runs for about 25 minutes, and nonfiction, which runs for 55. I'm really just going to be talking about nonfiction, but I feel like I should warn you, if you're going to hunt down a copy of the film, the fiction section centers on a very challenging race play sex scene where the consent is dubious. It's intentionally very hard to sit with and to pick apart. And I just don't want anyone to be blindsided by that after they hear me talk about the half of the film that turns on John Goodman being mind-controlled by his psychotic child.
And I will be your favorite from now on. If Brady dies, you can be sad for a little bit, but I will still be the most important person in your life. You will never be mean to me and always give me whatever I want.
Hey, Mikey. You want to get some ice cream?
Okay.
So, in nonfiction, Paul Giamatti plays Toby Oxman, a director who is making a documentary about a high school student, Scooby Livingston.
Scooby, Scooby, Scooby. What are you thinking? College, SATs, your parents, your brothers, your friends. How is it you deal with all this stress?
Scooby agrees to be in the documentary and hopes it will lead to him being famous. That's really his only ambition. He doesn't really have any talent or creative drive. He's incredibly passive, which makes him an ideal blank slate for Toby to project his muddled pretensions on.
For you, a quality that is emblematic of America today. It's part disillusionment, part hope.
And because he comes into this already knowing the kind of story he wants to tell, Toby misses a lot of what's really going on. For one thing, Scooby is queer in a deeply conservative family. But Toby doesn't pick up on any of that because he's too busy asking Scooby's brother if cool cars are important to the American teenager today. Toby doesn't treat Scooby as a person, but as a symbol of malaise and as an object of ridicule.
What is most important to you?
I don't know. I I'd like to be good at something. It doesn't have to be TV. I mean, it could be movies. Anything. Yeah, I'd be willing to direct.
And clearly, this is meant to be a bad documentary. Toby is a bad and incurious filmmaker. But it's also reflective of the process of storytelling itself. A process that is inherently reductive. Whatever is left in is not only emphasized, but becomes the thing. And the things that don't make it in, well, they're just absent. The documentary takes no notice of the youngest kid, Mikey, who has a real strong sent you to the cornfield energy?
How did that happen?
He was executed.
I mean, if he was guilty of doing something wrong, people who are bad should be killed. Don't you think so?
The character of Scooby that Toby creates in his documentary is flatter and simpler than the real Scooby. And it's not that Scooby has a whole lot of depth, but we do see parts of him that Toby isn't interested in. Or parts that Toby just can't see, like his dreams.
Hey, Scooby. How's it going?
Conan O'Brien? Whoa, what are you doing here?
I'm looking for a last-minute guest for my show. Any suggestions?
I'll be your guest.
Folks, what do you think? Should Scooby be my new sidekick?
Wow. Last year, a journalist from The New Yorker followed me around for a couple days to write an article about me, and that was very exciting and also very nerve-wracking. Like, this is a good thing. It can bring my work to a wider audience. But also, I was terrified about someone else telling my story and not having control over it, because what is the end result going to be, you know, especially as a trans woman, especially with a mainstream news source? And it made me pretty nervous, it made me pretty anxious, and a lot of my doubts and insecurities kind of just bubbled to the surface, and I was kind of a wreck the whole time. And I was really worried I was going to come across in the article as this, like, neurotic mess who did not know what she was doing. And that wasn't the case. Like, the article didn't include any of that and just focused on stuff where I sounded smart and insightful and like I knew what I was talking about. And so I come across pretty well in the article. There are some things that are missing that feel weird to me. Like, my partner Samhain was there the whole time and was part of every conversation, and when I had trouble expressing myself, she would jump in and help me. I really couldn't have done it without her, and she is such a major influence on the direction of my work now, and I did talk about that a lot, and in the article, she's barely there. She's like a bit part, and that feels crazy to me because she's such an important part of my life and my work now. A lot more ink is spilled on the hour or so we spent at Mary's house talking about how we met and how my dysphoria and depersonalization affected our relationship and how the transition had changed the nature of that relationship. And, like, that's part of my story, right? But I've already kind of lived past that. And it just seems weird to me that in the article, that takes up so much space. That is the story. All in all, I'm really happy with the way the article turned out. It's just, I sometimes have trouble recognizing the Amabel in the article as me. Something in the Dirt is from the same directors as Resolution, Benson and Moorhead. It's their most recent feature film before they started working on MCU stuff. It was shot in Benson's apartment during lockdown, starring the two of them, and it is the best thing they've done. Benson plays Levi, and there's something weird going on in Levi's apartment. Moorhead plays his neighbor John, and the two of them decide to make a documentary to investigate. The film is metatextually quite layered. As in storytelling, we get dramatic scenes intercut with footage from the documentary. But it's not quite that simple. The dramatic scenes often give way to quick-cut flourishes of the sort you might see in some documentaries.
Anything like a YouTube channel or something?
YouTube's like a whole, like, subscriber metadata algorithm, hot girl thumbnail, like, channel subscribe. I don't understand YouTube.
All the documentary footage turns out to be staged because the hard drives storing the footage were destroyed. There's no footage of any of the spooky things that happened, so they hire an FX team to create it. And then we have interviews with a series of editors who are holding the new footage hostage while waiting to be paid. So we have the dramatic scenes, we have the documentary's quote-unquote real footage, sort of. We have interviews outside the doc talking about the process of making it, and all of these things are quite porous.
Can we just do that last little bit, but just kind of like dark and mysterious so that you can kind of imagine the music?
Gotcha.
And bite the apple with finality at the end so we can cut out on it.
Finality, yep, got it. And then the phenomenon just dried up, just stopped.
Wait, can we do it without the glasses?
The question this brings up is less, what are we watching or what is reliable? But the more interesting question, who is telling the story? This question is really at the core of the film, as Levi and John struggle with each other for control, and that's filtered through the chain of custody of the various editing teams.
A little early for this, but I was thinking a little bit about the title. All right, check this out. Something in the light.
The door that wouldn't shut.
For the title. Yeah, it's cool.
Thank you.
It's probably got too many syllables though, you know, right?
Levi's not interested in explaining away what is clearly a supernatural thing. He conceptualizes it as an aberration in gravity. Gravity is a metaphor he returns to again and again throughout the film. The feeling like he's being held down or held back his whole life. Something mysterious beyond his control and understanding, preventing him from having agency. John, on the other hand, wants to solve it. A solution that involves a mishmash of ancient aliens, secret societies, apocalyptic Christianity, sacred geometry, and theoretical mathematics. All of these are things he happens to already be interested in, and each step of the mystery seems to have personal significance, like the universe is speaking to him in a code only he is smart enough to comprehend. It's no surprise when we find out some of the steps in the mystery were constructed by him, for him, to make himself the main character.
What exactly were the early Pythagorean city planners doing here? Well, it's the same thing as us. We're searching the gateway. The gateway, or science, meets magic. How's that?
That was great. I really like the accent.
Is that doing an accent?
No, sounds like a hobbit. It was awesome.
Should we retake it?
No, we're great.
Any ideas Levi has are dismissed or belittled, and when Levi expresses fear, when he asks over and over to stop, and when he tries to move away, John pushes him to continue. John is like, what if the guy from Pi had someone else besides himself to destroy? And Levi does get destroyed, he dies at the end. I hesitate to even call this a spoiler. The film tells us right at the beginning that one of them is going to die, and it's obvious it's Levi. It's not only the difference in the interview footage between the two of them, but Levi just looks, feels, and acts like he's doomed. So he floats out the window and into the sky, carried off by some strange gravity, and then plummets to his death, leaving John behind to tell the story.
He got to be part of something profound to break up his mundane existence, you know?
We get a few details of John's life, but we get a lot more of Levi's. things he absolutely wouldn't have wanted included if he was alive, his struggle with drugs, the death of his sister for which he feels responsible.
You know what, it makes a whole lot of sense that you turned your sister into a junkie. Did that kill her?
I knew something about that guy was... You know, and I'll say this. I can totally see why he wouldn't want to share something like that.
But John absolutely would want these included, both to make himself look more virtuous, and to make us feel like poor Levi is just doomed, that his death is inevitable, something for John to reflect wistfully on, instead of a thing John was culpable in. There's a scene where Levi reveals he's asexual, and rather than accept it or try to understand it, John explains Levi's own asexuality to him in terms of John's evangelical apocalyptic anxiety, a disregard of Levi's personhood that is profoundly monstrous. Everything about Levi, his life, his death, his secrets, everything is consumed by John, reducing Levi to a character, to a foil, to a reflection, to something John can use and derive meaning from.
But in a way, isn't this what we all do with the dead? We can't hold on to a whole person after they're gone. Over time, they slip away, and all we have left is what we can carry, what we can remember or choose to remember. They become the stories that we tell, and not the things that we forget or forgive. We can try to do this with nuance, try to hold on to as much of the complexity of a person as we can, but something is irretrievably lost. And this process of retroactive flanderization is a part of grief, a part of healing.
Lake Mungo is a 2008 horror film that, in a way, is about this process. The first and to date only feature by writer-director Joel Anderson, it takes the form of a documentary following a family grieving the death of drowning by their 16-year-old daughter, Alice. The film pays a lot of attention to the emotions of the family as they search for answers.
I hope that Alice did know how much I loved her. I guess I held something back a little as she grew older. That would be the saddest thing, to think she might not know.
Pretty soon, there's some unexplained noises and bad vibes, and Alice begins showing up in photographs and video footage taken by her brother Matthew. Halfway through the film, it turns out most of this has been doctored by Matthew to try to help his family in ways that aren't quite articulated.
Do you think that what you did ultimately made it worse for June?
I think that... Yeah, I probably did make it harder for her, but that wasn't my intention.
Here, the film segues from the question of, is there a ghost, to who was Alice? Up until this point, she's presented as young and happy, innocent and carefree, as a standard-issue symbol of a life tragically cut short.
Final respects to a young woman taken too soon.
She was a great person, very popular, clever, lovely.
Alice is remembered as a happy, fun-loving girl with a zest for life.
Her parents discover that the couple next door, who Alice babysat for, had groomed her into a sexual relationship. And it's a revelation the family doesn't quite know what to do with. They can't quite square it with their image of Alice.
Alice kept secrets. She kept the fact she kept secrets a secret.
In her diary, Alice describes a feeling of doom, something coming for her.
I just stood there paralyzed with fear, and I realized there was nothing that they could do for me anymore. I've never felt so utterly alone. Everything felt wrong. My body, the way things looked. Then I realized that there was something wrong with me.
these feelings of dread began after a class trip to Lake Mungo, and her parents find the phone she buried there, where she had a confrontation with something. An omen, her own ghost.
I feel like something bad is gonna happen to me. Or I feel like something bad has happened. It hasn't reached me yet, but it's on its way. And it's getting closer. And I don't feel ready. I feel like I can't do anything.
And this gives them closure. This gives them a story with an ending. And when they return, they decide Alice is gone. But she's not. She's still there. She's left behind, alone, and probably scared.
I don't think she knows I'm there. Alice isn't here.
Are you talking to her? Is she talking to you?
Oh, she's going now. She's leaving the room. She's gone.
In the end credits, it's revealed that in all the doctored footage, there's a real ghost also in frame. And I think the intention is the twist of it all. The scary thing was really there the whole time. But I found it incredibly heartbreaking. She was there and they couldn't see her, couldn't hear her, couldn't help her. They decided what happened, decided they had figured out who she was, and then left the real her behind. When my partner Salman shared this with me for the first time, we were both sobbing uncontrollably at the end. And this is maybe not the way most people respond to the end of this film, which is from the family's point of view and is about their pain, their grieving process. But by the end of the film, we identified with the ghost, with her pain, with what happens to you, the essence of who you were when you become the object of grief.
Everything felt wrong. My body, the way things looked, then I realized that there was something wrong with me.
I don't think I'm afraid of death. Like, I don't worry about what happens to my soul or my body after I'm dead. I don't even worry about, will my work last and give me some kind of immortality? Because my work's pretty experimental, so probably it's not going to last. The one thing is, I do want people to know that I was here and that I was Amabel. I fought so hard to be her. I think one reason why I tell my own story as often and as loudly and obnoxiously as I do is that no one can pretend that I wasn't Amabel. No one can take everything I did and put it under my dead name. I know a lot of trans people who don't like or use the term dead name. And I think that's fine. You know, use the terms, the terminology that works for you and describes your experiences. I've heard people say, it's not a dead name because I didn't die. I am the same person. I've been here the whole time. And I understand where they're coming from there. I really do. But it's not called a dead name because the old name died or because you killed the old name or the old life. It's called a dead name because that's the name they bury you under. That's the name they print in the newspaper so they can pretend that you weren't you. That's the story that your family or friends who didn't accept you tell about you when you're not there. Tell about you where you weren't trans, you weren't queer, you weren't you, but you were who they always said that you were. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, the word dead name first appeared in 2010. But they're wrong. This dates back at least to the 90s. If you talk to trans elders, they will tell you about it being used and passed down and through the community. Last year, a friend of mine found a zine from 2001 that used the term and explained its origin, and it was the earliest that either of us had ever seen it in print. I went to the website where it had been digitized to grab it for this video, and the website's gone now, because that's the internet we live with today. And me and my friend can say that we saw it, we can scream at the top of our lungs, but in the end, the story that's going to be told is that this word originated in 2010, a scary new thing from the internet, just like trans people are a scary new thing from the internet, because that's what happens when you let other people tell your story. They get it wrong. Sometimes they get it wrong on purpose. Sometimes they get it wrong for a purpose. Growing up, I didn't see trans stories or the stories I saw that cis people told about us. I didn't recognize myself in them, or I was frightened off. It wasn't until I saw other trans people talking about their actual experiences that I was able to recognize myself as a trans person. We're actually starting to get mainstream-ish trans films made by trans filmmakers. You've probably heard about I Saw the TV Glow, which is frankly a masterpiece. Writer-director Jane Schoenbrunn uses striking metaphors with messy, overlapping, sometimes contradictory meanings to evoke the turbulence of being closeted, the way it can hollow you out, the fear that makes you run from yourself.
You won't even remember that you're dying.
At this point, I'm going to watch anything this director makes, but that was already true because of their first film. In 2021, they wrote, edited, and directed We're All Going to the World's Fair, which is about a viral creepypasta challenge. You do this little ritual, and then you're supposed to have these body horror side effects, which people record and post on the internet. Usually, they are ecstatic about the ways their body is changing, which could make this a metaphor for puberty. The film centers on Casey, and her videos are different. She's not growing wings or turning into plastic or pulling tickets from her arm. Her body isn't becoming something wonderful. She's being alienated from it.
It was like watching myself on a TV all the way across the room, and I was aware of my actions. Yes, granted, I was aware, but I couldn't control myself.
It's a metaphor for gender dysphoria and depersonalization. And it's important to note that Casey chooses this metaphor, chooses to use this horror ARG to explore and express these feelings, which she may or may not even have the words for. The film is very careful to emphasize the way in which Casey's videos and online persona are constructed. We see her restart a take, we see her abandon a video idea only to come back to it later. We are watching her creative process. There's only one other major character in the film, JLB, who becomes parasocially fixated on Casey's videos. He tries to tell her about what the World's Fair Challenge really is. He's going to help her with the lore so she doesn't get tripped up. He warns her about what he thinks is happening in her own videos.
And I don't really know you, but I feel like I do. And I want to save you.
And she's like, hey, you don't get to tell me that.
But this guy, he's just walking around like he knows everything. I hate people like that that know everything. They just always are like, well, no, this is how it is. Who are you to tell me how it is? Who are you to tell me how it is? I don't know.
The videos feel too real for him, and when she starts to tease homicidal and suicidal ideation as part of this creepy horror thing she's making, he worries that she's unable to distinguish reality and fantasy and considers calling the police on her.
You thought about calling the fucking police? Jesus Christ. But they're just videos. What is wrong with you? They're pretend. Okay, I have to go. That's not even my name.
The final minutes of the film are focused on JLB.
he records a video telling us that she reached out a year later, that they became friends, and she kept apologizing for how she treated him, but he was magnanimous about it. This version he's made up tells him that on the night of their argument, she was transported to the World's Fair and almost swallowed up by it, but she could feel him praying for her, and that brought her back to reality. He saved her, and she's so thankful. It's incredibly upsetting to see him making up this story, overwriting her into what he wanted her to be. He even does a voice for her dialogue, fully taking her over as a person. It's maybe the most horrifying thing in the film.
It was like she knew she was about to say something that she shouldn't. And I made it there. I know it sounds crazy, but it's true.
Watching this for the second time, I noticed a name in the credits. One of the executive producers is David Lowery, who is an accomplished filmmaker in his own right. He also shot one of the scenes in the last feature film Mary and I co-directed, back in 2007. I had asked Joe Swanberg to do a cameo in the film, and he asked Lowery to operate the camera. I never met or talked to either of them. The film was about dysphoria and depersonalization, but it'd be another 13 years before I knew that. So the film is just me thrashing around incoherently in a pain I don't understand or have words for. It didn't get into any festivals. None of our films did. Maybe I wasn't good enough. Maybe Mary and I clashed too much. Maybe I didn't know who I was, so I didn't know what I wanted to say. The real question isn't why didn't I make it as a filmmaker, but why did I stop trying? Why did I stop making films? It was so important to me. There was a man who got fixated on me, a guy from the internet. He was just kind of angry at a whole group of filmmakers, really, the kind of mumblecore folks. And he felt that their success was manufactured and undeserved and would rail about it online. And because I asked Joe to do that cameo and because Andrew Pajowski once said something very nice about one of my films, this guy felt that I was one of them, that I was part of that whole circle. I was best friends with them in his mind. And also, I was not successful. I was not playing festivals or getting reviews in newspapers. So I also was more vulnerable. And I think that made me a more acceptable target. And so I was the one that he fixated on. And I'm not going to tell you what he said or what he did. You don't get to know that. But I wanted it to stop. And so when one of my films fell apart, when Mary lost her job and money got tight, when I fell into board games and found success there, it became very easy for me to just stop making films. And when I stopped, he stopped. And after I figured myself out, after transition started, I found my movie love coming back something fierce, like this desire to make films, to tell stories, to tell trans stories, to reach a broader audience than my weird niche board game so I could help people. They could see themselves on the screen and know something about themselves. And I want that. I want that so bad. But I know that if I got that kind of audience, there would be so many eyes on me, so many people picking me apart and remixing me, turning me into something that they can hate or stand or ship or use until all that's left is the story that they tell about me. And that price just feels too big.